Hey, I'm Janek Gwizdala. It's the Janek Gwizdala podcast. Welcome to Not My Studio. We're sort of out on location today. Yes, albeit like I just walked out of that door where my studio is and came into the big room where I have the gym and the pool table and basically where I have my huge storage over here, that all of this that you see before you was stuffed into. I was just grabbing something small the other day and I saw the corner of that big ugly flight case sticking out and thought, damn, I still have that. At some point, I thought it was a great idea to be on the road with something that huge. And to a certain extent, it was. It was definitely the right tool for the job at the time. But how times have changed over the years, it's crazy. I wanna really recap, review, dig into almost all of the cases for bases, for gear, for pedals, for pedal boards that I've had over the course of my career. And through doing so, maybe we find something that could work for you, something that makes sense for your situation. That's what you always have to ask yourself. What do I need? Where am I going? How am I going? What am I taking? And then what are the options? I have some of them here. I have a good representation of some of the basic ones here. Obviously not all of them. Some I'm going to be a champion of and be like, hey, I think this is the best way to go. This is what works great for me. Some of them, as you'll see a bit later on, I am not a fan of at all. And another part of it was one of these is actually literally going in the trash can tomorrow. I was like, let me make a quick all-encompassing case travel gear video before that one goes so we can look at two ends of the spectrum. And I think we'll get going, first of all, by saying that, you know, this base hiding right behind me back here, this is the last one. Oops. Oh yeah. Okay. I almost fell over. This is the last one on the chopping block that is going out of the collection. This Mayonnaise Jabber 5. I've had it for about 12 years. It was a custom build from Mayonnaise. Made some videos for them back in the day with this one. Has Aguilar pickups, has a Buckeye bell top. Just to say, this is the last one on the chopping block. I've been sort of purging a lot of instruments recently and making space for things that I'm gonna use a little more, some sort of specialist things that I'm having made for upcoming projects. So that is available on the website. Just wanted to throw that out there before we get into all of these crazy cases. And maybe let's start with a massively positive. I wanna go super, I wanna stay like 99% positive on this whole episode of the podcast, but I wanna start with something that is very near and dear to my heart and has probably done about 1.5 million miles, if I had to ballpark it. I know I've done, with United Airlines alone, over 2 million, and I've had this case since probably 2001 or two. It's by Levy's, L-E-V-Y-S, Canadian company, who are not sponsoring this video. None of the people, none of the companies, none of the products I'm about to show you are sponsoring this video. In fact, when it comes to cases, that's probably the area that I've had, let's say, the least, the least amount of relationships with companies on. You know, I've purchased almost everything you see in front of you, including this. This is probably one of the most expensive things for a gig bag that I bought. Off the top of my head, I can't really remember how much it was. I want to say, A, that in 2001 or 2002 when I got it, it was a lot of money. So I'm going to guess that means, and it's still a lot of money, right? I'm going to guess that means somewhere in the $250 to $400 range, maybe around $300. I can't be sure. But as you see before you, before we get to the straps, which have really taken a battering, it's still in very working condition. Obviously, it has wear and tear that you would completely expect for a case that's over 20 years old and has done, you know, over 1.5 million miles on the road with me, just on planes. It's super thick padded. I always felt like, man, I could maybe even check the instrument without a hard case in this, and a couple of times had to gate check it because those were the days when I was trying to carry it on. You can tell it's been a while since they used it because the United Airlines 1K card is A, bent and beat up and dirty, but they also haven't made a 1K card that looks like that in quite a number of years. The reason I haven't used it in a while is what's back here. I really hope, guys and girls of the bass world, that if you are just listening to this on Spotify or wherever you listen to audio podcasts, that you do jump over to the YouTube channel and get a good look at the straps on this thing. So the right shoulder strap, where I predominantly carried it for those years, is, I mean, it's literally threadbare, because I see about 6 or 7 threads holding it together. That's about to go. I switched to the left shoulder for a while and that started to go. I mean, it's really had some treatment. But despite all of that, I could replace these straps and it would function for another 50 years, I think. Love this case. Don't use it so much anymore. It is a little on the heavier side. Not that that bothers me so much, because of my, you know, my status with the airline and the fact that I'm able to carry, 3 bags at 70 pounds for free, which is a really useful perk of doing all your miles with the same airline. We'll get to that when we get into the flight cases. I want to talk about my philosophy a little bit behind that. I know I've talked about it before, but I've never done it with all of this stuff to use as an example. So there it is. That's really quite emotional looking at that, because that's had so much use. Massive pocket, big buckles on the front, by the way. Just so many great memories of running to gigs with that one. I don't know where I'm going to put all of these. Maybe I'll put them to one side. Whew, as I get through them. I've got so many things that I would, maybe it's not obvious, but I was about to say that it's obvious I would never use to travel with. Not least of all, this sort of Fender style, this Fender style case, right? Oh, there's actually a bass in there. What is this? Okay, that doesn't happen all the time. I have no idea what this is. I doubt it's mine. It's not mine. It's my wife's, Jackson. not sure I've ever seen that before. I didn't realize we had this bass. I know it has to be my wife's because it's not mine, but that's probably a good example of what this style of case is good for, which is storage. That's basically what we're using it for here. If I spin that around so you can see what's inside, it's that typical Fender sort of plush, velvety interior with the massive pocket underneath. Bunch of crap in here, some old strings. Whole bunch of things. Actually, I know what this case is for, because I'm looking at this Gacky Center. This is the case that my medium scale jazz bass came in from Japan. That's the case that it came with. This is generally, if a bass doesn't come with it, just a gig bag, especially the Fenders, it quite often comes with one of these flat cases. And I seem to remember on that trip, when I came home after getting that bass from Japan, and I think the bag tags on here will reflect, NRT. So it says NRT on here, which is Narita, which means Tokyo to LAX. ANA, it was a code share on Star Alliance, and that must have been, I mean, that's well over a decade ago, or maybe it's exactly a decade, maybe that's about 2014 that I got this bass. And what I would have done is actually just checked this without the bass in it, and grabbed a gig bag from somewhere and tried to carry it on, because I really don't trust these as a hard case. If I see musicians with this style of case at the airport, I mean, it's just a massive eye roll and a head shake, saying like, you are really rolling the dice if you think this is the way to go with any kind of instrument. I seem to remember the whole United Breaks guitars thing 10 or 12 years ago, when I actually like looked closely at what these guys had checked their instruments in. I was like, you're out of your mind. You're checking them in bullshit cases like this. So yeah, there's definitely a little bit of common sense, I guess, that should go into it when you look at a case and be like, oh, is that actually gonna do anything if somebody throws it? So that's, you know, that's something that's more storage, and apparently we're storing a bass in there that I sort of had no idea about. Let's go with, this is something I see more and more often. Now, this isn't the brand I see most often, but it's the style of gig bag I see quite often when I'm when I'm in the airport. This happens to be a beautiful gig bag. This is from F-Base. I'm not sure if they make them themselves or they farm it out and put their logo on it. I'm guessing they farm it out and put their logo on it, but you'll have to look into that. I don't know for sure. It's a beautiful bag. It's really nicely branded as well. I love that F-Base thing in the back. Let me turn this around. actually got two cameras going on here today. It's all happening. It's so such a different style of podcast, and hopefully this works out because I want to do more of these sort of bigger episodes. But yeah, I love the fact that it's nice and branded on the back. It's super comfortable on the back when you take it to a gig. I've actually just noticed something I've never seen before, which is that meant to be a pocket? I'm not even sure that's meant to be a pocket, but you could definitely store some things in there. I love the grab handle on the back. I love the grab handle on the bottom, and it's not a handle that sticks out. It's like a elevated piece of, that's like faux leather or something. And just the quality of the bag. I think you could probably check a bass in this that you weren't, so precious about. You might be able to get away with checking a bass in that on a flight. But either way, I think that's a great in-town, gigging in town, or if you're gonna be on the road and you're in a van and you don't have to fly anywhere, it's an awesome gig bag, this style of it. I see a lot of the mono cases. I have a pedalboard bag we'll look at here in a second, but I see a lot of those mono cases as well that are this style, pretty chunky, more sturdy sides, giving more support to the instrument. I see that a lot. But unfortunately, I see a lot of people struggling to get on the plane with those things. These things are massive. This isn't a trumpet or an alto saxophone or a violin. This takes up half an overhead bin if you're lucky enough to find an overhead bin that it even fits in. So I always see that in the planes. I'm like, man, like, just stop. I've been hanging out with Ian Martin Allison a couple of weeks ago, whose philosophy is the polar opposite. And he's like, every single gig is carry on only clothes and mini pedal board and bass. And so I know it's not for everyone, and everyone has a different way of doing it. It's just for me personally, at this point in my life, struggling to get on a plane, especially with a gig bag as chunky as this, as great as it is, man, it's so much stress. And it's a big old thing to carry through the airport as well, especially if it's packed full of stuff. The theme throughout all of this, throughout this entire episode of the podcast, will be stop being so precious with your instruments. You don't have to travel with a $50 million bass. Even me, as specialized as and specific and as niche as what I do as an artist is, pretty much at the point where I can, show up anywhere in the world and play any old bass that I might find at the last second if mine were to get delayed. So I'm always trying to push that narrative a little bit and to encourage people to be a little less precious with their instruments and have maybe a little easier travel time and a little less stress moving through airports. Again, you have to ask yourself what you're doing. Are you mainly in a van or on a bus or something, and you're not flying that much, so it doesn't apply to you so much. For me, it's almost all flying. I would say I do about 10% by road, and the rest of it is in the air. So it's, a lot of that time is spent connections and long haul and really moving through airports, and I try to carry as little gear as possible. So that's the F-Bass. Really, really like that gig bag. And I think all of their basses come with one. So if you get an F-Bass, you'll be in line for one of those, and it's great. Chelsea has an F-Bass, I have an F-Bass, so we actually have two of these cases in the house. Pretty awesome. More gig bags. Here's an old one. Here's an oldie but goodie. This is by Reunion Blues. Again, this is not something that was given to me, not a company that's sponsoring the podcast, although they too have a similar one to the F-Bass one we just looked at, which I really like. I haven't used it to travel with. I think Tim LaFave uses that. That's who hipped me to it. And I went to check it out at a NAMM show a few years ago and was pretty impressed by it. Again, not something I would like 100% rely on to check my instrument, but for gigging around town, I think it's an awesome bag. This one is an absolute monster of a bag because it's a double bag. It's the Reunion Blues double bass bags. This is old as well. I probably got this in 1996, 97. So this is, wow, this is maybe 28 years old. And it's in amazing shape considering the amount I used it. Maybe not as much as the Levies because I just didn't really want to travel with two basses that much. But yeah, it's got that divider in the middle, really padded and thick, and not those kind of more robust walls to the side of the case, not like the F-base one. But definitely, you know, I used to carry my two wall bases around in here, the fretless and the fretted. I used this all through Berkeley. It was my only gig bag. I used to carry two bases around everywhere I went. I was out of my mind. Again, the things that, you know, these straps are in pretty good condition actually, but the little connectors in the bottom could probably do with replacing. The bottom, yeah, everything's in really amazing condition on that. And I don't know what it cost me back in the day. It was in the UK. It was long before I moved to the US, so it would have been in pounds. So I'm not sure what that would have been. Not cheap. I'm sure they make a double bag. Almost everyone makes a version, a double bag version of their cases now. But a great option, you know, that's something I would use. Like if I had a longer tour that was mainly in a van, if I really didn't have to fly except to get to the first date and to get back from the last date, I might consider using that. And of course, if I really needed two bases, maybe I needed a fretless and a fretted every night. It's a great option. Let's see. Let's go on. I don't want to, you know, I want to keep it positive, and I want to make, you know, this is a Mayonnaise. This is what a Mayonnaise base comes. Maybe there's even a Mayonnaise base in here. Let's check it out. Oh yes, there is. Look at this beauty. Woo. That's for if I'm doing any sort of proggy or genty or, you know, more kind of rock slap type of things. Really nice instrument. That's something that's kind of unique. That's going to stay with me. It's a Prestige Classic 5. I got that back in, it says February 2017. Really nice instrument, used it on a bunch of tracks, made a couple of videos with it actually. It's good to also, you know, keep for the pedal videos, for the pedal studio when I'm doing something kind of overdriven and a little heavier. So that one's staying, and that's got a soap bar in it. Oh, shit, I haven't looked at this bass in a while. We didn't intend to get into the basses on this episode, but it does have an interesting setup with the soap bar and then the super double in the front. Anyway, the point being is a lot of instruments get delivered in a gig bag. Nothing crazy. It will, you know, protect your instrument if you throw it in the car and take it to a gig. It's not a bad thing to store it in here if you can keep it upright or, you know, somewhere where it's not, doesn't have stuff put on top of it. But it's not the most amazing gig bag in the world. And a lot of companies are like this. Like almost every company has their version of like the cheap and cheerful gig bag. It's nicely branded. I think all Mayonnaise bases come with that, but I basically needed to pick this instrument up at the NAMM show and get it home, and that gig bag absolutely served that purpose. But that's sort of the maximum amount you're ever going to use it. So that's that. And in fact, now that I remember that instrument is in there, I'm probably going to take that out and store it somewhere in one of these hard cases that we're going to look at. Okay, so this is my current day-to-day gig bag and touring gig bag, and it's a great way to segue into the flight cases as well, because this is made by Slick Bag, and it's obviously branded, Mattison branded, with a little Swedish flag on there. I appreciate that. I believe they're a Swedish company. Here's the updated Premier 1K badge, so you can see the difference. This is really the one I use all the time. And this has done, you know, several hundred thousand miles, if not about 500,000 miles over the, yeah, actually, wow. It's probably done over 500,000 miles already, and I've only been using it for about 5 years. Three compartments on the front. I always have an Apple AirTag in there. It's a very important point, actually. Something that technology is really helping us with here is being able to have an Apple AirTag in just everything. I put one in the pedal board, I have one in my wallet, one in my carry-on, one in my luggage, put one in the base always. So even if it gets delayed and it doesn't make a connection and it doesn't make it on a flight when I'm on the road, at least I kind of know where it is. I know if I need to, like, you know, get a base for one night, or if I'm going to have to, you know, work out some things for a few nights before it catches up with me. Really useful tool and pretty inexpensive considering what it does for you. This is great. I don't think I've ever realized that there was a neck strap in here to help, you know, keep that in place. I've never used it, so that's whatever it is. It's a really nice, solid gig bag, really robust. And here's the thing, the whole like philosophy behind the way I travel with the instrument is when I get somewhere, and when I get somewhere having flown and flown with a flight case, I don't want to have to drag that flight case to and from the gig to the hotel, like just around with me. I want to be able to go to the hotel, drop the flight case portion off, and take out the gig bag and travel light to and from the gig. So I can't often pack the pockets on here when I'm flying full of stuff because it ends up being a little bit wide. But in terms of going to and from the gig from the hotel, these pockets are awesome. Some tours I've done with just an HX Stomp or an HX Stomp XL, that fits in there. A cable, a pencil, eraser, just basic stuff, my music if I need it. It's an amazing gig bag. And right now it goes in, as you regular viewers will be probably aware, it goes in one of these bad boys, the SKB Base Safe. Let's lose this. The stack over here is growing, and let's get into the SKB Base Safe. This is something that I went back and forth on for so long, and you can see right here these straps that it comes with. Actually, not the straps, but the buckle that connected these straps around the end of the instrument was absolute garbage. It kind of joined here and set in this recess, and it's just a plastic piece of crap. And it was the weak point. It was the 100% the point of failure every single time something went wrong with this case. And so many times, bear in mind, oops, oh. That is loud on the mic. Bear in mind, I have three of these things now. So many times it would arrive. Oh, TSA, notice of baggage inspection. Thank you so much. So many times it would arrive on the carousel when I got to my destination in two pieces like this, and the base would be half sticking out or even floating around on its own. Not optimal. That was until I was hanging out with Damien Erskine, who also uses this case and who also had never had an issue with the strap breaking, but he sensibly, I wish I'd thought of this years ago, it would have saved me a lot of grief. He very sensibly came up with the safety mechanism of putting something around these two handles. They're really like quite chunky and they meet in the middle. They're nice and it's a nice and solid join. And he told me he used something like a dog collar, like he literally had a spare dog collar from his dog laying around the house. I think that was the story, and put it around here. I mean, so simple, so effective. So if the strap broke, the whole thing stayed together. So I went home after that trip, and I was like, man, I can't believe his buckle didn't break. I get a text like maybe 2 weeks later saying, dude, I don't know what it is, but finally my buckle broke. So maybe it's me, maybe I'm cursed, maybe I had a bad influence on him. So he did end up having the same issue as me, but he had the dog collar. I have these little Velcro straps that I put two of them actually around the middle like that. And so far I've been back with this case probably a year and a half, I guess, 2 years since I've been back on the road. And those two Velcro straps, I've never had a problem with it. I can't even pull it apart more than like a fraction of a millimeter if I'm really like putting all my strength into it. It's an amazingly strong case. So, point being is that this thing is super light, super strong. It's got wheels, it's got a really nice fixed grab handle, and this, my main gig bag, fits perfectly inside it. So when I get to the gig, I leave the two hard shell pieces, when I get to the hotel rather, I leave the two hard shell pieces behind and off I go with the gig bag. So that is my current and probably for the foreseeable future, very long future, touring setup, but I don't envisage changing so much. That is annoyingly just still in the shot. Let's move that out of the way. And let's go to something I used like in a transition. What should we do first? Should we do the thing I was using or the thing I transitioned to? All right, let's get this out of the way. Let's use the thing I was using for a little while that I had such high hopes for, and it ended up really not working out at all. This was the Groove Gear capsule. It was nice in thought, at least, but realistically not a professional. This is more like prosumer kind of grade rather than being a professional piece of touring gear. And I can't say that it really, you know, I didn't put it through like some insane, like I didn't drag it up a mountain to play. I just really didn't hit it that hard, and it did not hold up to what I was giving it. I did flying, I did van stuff, I did trains, I did moving through the city. It was the one, initially the one downside that I was like, okay, I'll compromise on that because it's got so many other features. And the thing I was compromising on was not being able to have a gig bag when I got to the hotel. I had to take the whole thing from the hotel to the gig. Now, on paper, these nice skateboard wheels should have made that really slick to just pull it through whatever city I was in. In reality, they're way too high. The whole thing is way too unstable. It totally doesn't work. Every you hit a tiny pebble in the road and the thing is on its back. Another element of that is the fact that this grab handle, which technically is a nice idea because it comes off and you can store it for when you check the bag. But in reality, this just spins around. Like this would need to be like affixed to the end of the case and be a firm grip to where you could control the balance of the case. I'm not sure if having the firm grip here would take care of the height of the wheels. Either way, I think it should be a solid grip and have the wheels recessed. The other thing, great idea again, in theory, was that you have a little spring-loaded clip here, and these wheels come off. You can put them inside the case when you check it. We all know how wheels are one of the first things to get destroyed on any piece of luggage we use. So, in theory, a fantastic idea, except when the spring departs on you, when the spring pin is incredibly cheap and the setup is not high quality enough to last, you know, to put it through the paces of being a professional musician on tour. So as you can see, this one, can you see it? Yeah, as you can see, this one has the little pin that's working. This one doesn't. That it literally happened, and this is like the third time. To their credit, Groove Gear did send me a replacement pin once. But literally the next tour I went on, I showed up at the airport and I rolled my thing up to the counter to check in. I went to take it off and it broke again. So from the beginning of the tour, I had to leave the wheels on. Hey, they survived, to their credit. But that's not what the feature is intended for. It was intended to come off. What else on here? I think it's meant to be a really sturdy case in terms of the carbon fiber and the epoxy, but as you can see, it's almost worn through. It's definitely worn through two layers. I don't give it too much longer to go right through the skin here. That's not great. And then the zips, super cheap, unfortunately, and they're just gone and they've just pulled apart all the way around the bottom here. Like this one, for instance, is completely toasted. I can put my finger through there, the other corner as well. It's all lifting away. Just cheap. This one's literally going in the trash. It's really expensive, unfortunately. They gave me a break on it, like an artist deal, but even then it was still more expensive than, even with the artist deal, it was still more expensive than the SKB base safe, which, obviously doesn't have as many features, but the only feature I really want is to get my instrument there in one piece. All of the other internal compartments and the concept of it being, hey, maybe a good weekend thing where you could put some clothes and some few pieces of gear and the bass and just check one thing. Yeah, conceptually, cool. But in reality, like really like putting it through some paces, not even on the extreme level, it didn't hold up at all. So that one, it's going in the trash. That's about the only thing I can do with it at this point. Now, what I transitioned to before I went back to the SKB base safe was, a little pause for the cause here, was this chunky thing from SKB. And it's something that I remember being in Boston Logan Airport. This is when I still had Instagram. This is a few years ago, pre-pandemic. And I showed up and the thing had happened. The buckle had snapped, the two things were in pieces and the bass was out of the flight case. And I took a picture of it and I tagged SKB in it. I was like, come on, man, it's like the 15th time this has happened. Yeah, what the fuck? To their credit, they DM'd me the same day, a couple of hours later, and they said, hey, can we send you something else? Obviously not an SKB base safe. I hadn't thought about putting the straps on it at that point. And they sent me this. It's the I-Series, SKB Cases I-Series. It says waterproof on there. It's a chunky case. It looks like a rifle case. I get that question, even with the base safe, with almost any of my flight cases, I get the question every time I check in. Hey, is that a gun? Is there ammunition? And I'm like, no. Just a musician. So this is, let's see, when did I use this? They never put the date on the bag tag, but I definitely flew from Denver back to Burbank at some point. I think this was coming from Atlanta, and there was just a moment before I, you know, the capsule had died. I knew that was over. I didn't have a solution for the SKB base safe yet, and I just needed to go and do like a one-off gig. And when you open this up, it has foam in it. You can see, so ghetto. I did do a really rough cutout for my Matteson in here, as you can see. But actually, when you take all of this foam out and just have it as, when you take these two top pieces out and just have that lower layer in there, you can actually fit a gig bag in there. So it sort of was conceptually very similar to the SKB base safe, and I used that just a couple of times. I think I played a gig up in San Francisco, I played a gig out in Atlanta a couple of years back, and sorry for the big, they got really big clasps. Okay, that's the last one. And you know, it served a purpose. Right now, I'm keeping it because at some point I know I'm gonna, if not move full-time, at least live part-time in Europe, and I'm gonna need to take instruments out there. So it'll be a great, sort of almost like just a shipping container specific to base. So that's sort of why it's sticking around. And there's one, one more hulking flight case. I don't even know how to get this thing out. And let's move some of this other stuff and bring this a little closer. This thing, and you can see some of the stickers on it, some of the old tags. God, it's so heavy. Oh my word. Oh, just sitting next to this thing brings back some funny memories. And you can see, this is NYC, this is Japan Airlines. What's going on here? Jem, Vivi Brown, Janek, third encore. Like, there are stickers on here as to where it's going. Janek number two of something. Like, you kind of have all your gear tagged up when you're on a bigger tour. And a bigger tour is the key here. That's what this was used for. Am I gonna destroy my ottoman here by putting this up? Let's be gentle. In fact, let's turn it around to the camera so you can see it. I mean, it's like carrying a keyboard. Like, if I did the foam slightly differently, I could get a Yamaha motif in this thing. It's a big anvil case, huge locks. Like, I think they guaranteed that you could drop this out of like a fourth story window onto the street and it would be fine. So here it is, super dense foam. This is from back in the day when I had a Federa. So this is cut out for the Federa. You can see a little gear area in here, but it's very basic. It does one thing. It gets an incredibly expensive instrument from A to B without a scratch on it. And they're really expensive. I have no idea what it would cost now. I think they're a custom build, or I'm not sure actually. I actually don't remember on that. This is more for like nostalgia's sake and just to show you some insanity of what it used to be like going on the road. So if you can picture this, we'll get to the flight cases for pedals in just a second. But if you can picture this, like the stack of cases that I would take on a bigger tour, like this would be one of them for sure. That'd have the Federa in it. I'd probably have another couple of these like SKB I series style cases. This isn't the only one I've owned. I've had a few more of these over the years, but got rid of them or sold bases and sold them with those cases. I'd have probably two or three of those with a couple of fenders. maybe something, you know, some specialty bass in it or short scale or something if I needed it. And then at one point I was touring with an upright as well. You can just about see my one of my wife's upright basses right there leaning up against the wall. It's huge. I think it's a 3/4 size and it's still enormous. And that's in a gig bag. That's what she uses to go to the studio in LA to go and play gigs around town. That goes in the back of the car. The flight case for one of those things is insane. I can stand upright inside it. I had one where you could take the neck off. My friend Massimo Bilcati sold me this bass, and it was bright orange flight case, but it was a little bit smaller, a little bit easier to take on the road. So there was the huge upright. There was this big flight case. There were three of these solid flight cases that would all get rocket cargoed up and, you know, sent to the first city of the tour or shipped out to the bus, wherever that was starting. It was a considerable amount of gear. And especially when you think back in the day, I was doing backing tracks and being a musical director. So there was a whole rack of stuff on wheels with DA88s or HD24s or whatever we were using at the time, a whole bunch of that stuff. And then of course the pedal board things. I don't have my original SKB pedal board where the lid, I don't even know what it was called. I used to use that like on Jojo Mayer tours. It had integrated power built in and stuff, but it was really, it was kind of shit. They weren't great. That was a real, compared to what we have now, it was okay for the time, I guess. Unfortunately, I don't have that. I probably have pictures of it somewhere. Maybe I'll try and share those at some point. What happened after that was I went to the pedal train thing, which is so often the first move, or at least it was back in that time. I saw a lot of people doing that. This kind of pedal train, this is the pedal train 2, I think. Is that what that is? No number on it, but you know, the kind of pretty standard pedal train, pedal board. And then I had this super chunky flight case for it, and not particularly great, I don't think. Just big and boisterous. And dirty. These things haven't been out of storage in a long time, and really uncomfortable to carry. Like if I close this up, just even one clip. This handle caused me so much pain. I remember doing lots of touring in Japan and being on the train, you know, being on the Shinkansen. And there's no wheels on this thing, so I'd have my bass on my back, like back in the days of carrying it on. I'd have my bass on my back, I have my luggage with my clothes, and then I have this thing in one hand, and that handle was so terrible. It really wasn't great. In fact, are we seeing more? Oh yeah, ANA, we're seeing Narita. These are all Japanese stickers on here from flights. Maybe the last time I used it was a long time ago in Japan, but yeah, lots of stuff on the train with that. Not a lot of fun. And when you compare it to what we have access to today, oh boy. We have come such a long way. I'm very happy about that. Now, something I did not that long ago, I'm guessing Bob Reynolds tour, maybe the one in early 2020, right as the pandemic was taking shape. I used this. I ended up thinking, okay, I'm gonna carry my pedals on. I'm at that point where actually my pedal board is probably the most important part of my setup and my sound. So it's something I want to, you know, if I know I have a tight connection, if I get a feeling that maybe the bags won't make it, you know, I do it now, but this was like the first time I did it for the entire tour. I tend to carry the pedals on. I think I actually had one of those pedal train boards that I just showed you in that hard case. Right now, this is more storage than anything. I have this huge Vertex Effects, you know, monster pedal board with the riser. You may or may not have seen me do board builds with this before. That's not something I'm going to put in a carry-on, I don't think. That just happens to be in here. But this is the Mono M80 Series Tour 2.0, M80 Tour V2. It's a fantastic bag. It's really nice. The shoulder strap is awesome. I now use this when I'm in town. I'll put my regular smaller board in here and some cables, and what I can even throw my amp in here as well. And that's it. It goes from my house to the car. It goes from the car to the gig. It's great for that. what I didn't anticipate and what I obviously didn't train for or research enough. I didn't like walk up and down the street with this thing on. Before that tour in 2020, I just had no idea how heavy the thing actually was when you really have to carry it. When, you know, you land at London Heathrow, if like me, I fly United a lot. So United, the gates all the way, like the B gates all the way to security, to immigration is over a mile. And when you're like in a daze and you've just woken up after a night flight and you're like, oh, what the fuck? And you have to carry this thing, it's a total drag. So that entire tour was basically like that. It was carrying this thing every single day. It destroyed both of my shoulders. And yeah, it wasn't the best way to go. If I'd have had something far lighter, it might have worked. Maybe a smaller bag, smaller pedal board could have been more manageable. But either way, they actually, it's one of the few bags that I got sent for free. Mono were really, really nice. They reached out, and I think I posted something on social media at the time. And they reached out, and they sent me this for the tour. And it is a great bag. It's something I won't be getting rid of anytime soon. It's something I still use a lot for gigging in town. Now, we're getting right down to it here. The last two pieces, the big boys. Big boys, actually not so big. Actually quite compact. They're identical except for color. Let's go with the blue one because it's the one I use most right now. It's a Pelican 1510. This is their quote unquote carry-on case, and you can have it configured inside a number of different ways. I actually have it configured with the carry-on lid. So I have all of these compartments. I have my Apple AirTag down there, always in the board. I have this little padded insert, and the pedal board sits in that, just gives it a little bit of cushion. I have these pads that I put on top, so it's shielded from the top. I also put one of those pads on the bottom section, on the bottom deck of my pedal board, and then put a couple of loose pedals like my volume pedal on top. And it all goes in there. I put spare cables, spare patch cables, maybe a couple of tools, very simple. And that is my pedal board case. They're not cheap. I think they're $300 or $350. Ooh, that's it. But you can hear from the clunk of the snaps of the catches that Pelican is just kind of indestructible. It's always been their thing. They've made videos like driving over these things with a tank, and they still survive. They drop them in the water. What does it say on here? It has a waterproof O-ring seal. I'm sure you guys know Pelican cases, and there are other options I think from other companies in a similar vein. This is just what I choose to use, and as you can see from the size of it, that is significantly smaller than a lot of the regular carry-on luggage you see people trying to haul onto a plane and put in the overhead. This, you know, front on like that will go in an overhead no problem. Of course, with a pedal board in it, it's a little heavier than most people's carry-on. You have to be a little slick with that, and you know, you gotta have some strength in your upper body so you can pick it up and throw it in the overhead like it's nothing. You know, people may, you know, flight attendants may question you if you're struggling and trying to get this thing in there. But the more I see insane people getting on planes, I think maybe this is your first time flying or something, but you see them getting on planes and it's like, are you seriously bringing all of that in the cabin? It makes me feel way less bad about bringing this with me. And let's be very clear, only sometimes. It goes back to that thing of, do I have a tight connection? Do I think that maybe the bags could get delayed on this one? Then I'll bring the pedal board. Still, I'm not bringing the bass. The bass is always going under. And yeah, that's sort of the way I do it. So I get to breeze through the airport with a little backpack or even just a laptop case. I've made some trips recently that have been really, really quick where I haven't even had that. I've just had the phone and you know, my ID, and that's basically it. And everything else is underneath. It's a very relaxing way to fly. I know it's not everyone's cup of tea. I know not everyone wants to check their instrument, but I would really encourage you to try and be way less precious when it comes to that. And the more you can get into that mode of, hey, I think I can probably play anything. And don't think I just like flipped a switch one day. It took some time. It took like getting you know, into all of the instruments I own and being like, okay, I'm really going to practice on something totally different to get out of my comfort zone, to sort of make it my new comfort zone, essentially. And yeah, it's very, very freeing. I know a lot of people aren't going to agree with that, and then you're going to carry on doing your thing and carrying it on. But if you can, just experiment with checking it and getting a decent case. The SKB base safes are not that expensive. I think about 180, I want to say 189, some random number like that. And considering, you know, I have three, but I kept buying them because the straps broke. I could have stayed with one, and I think they'll last, forever. I've had this one for maybe 10 years, and besides the strap, it's working great. I've talked about it before, I'll talk about it again. Do all your miles with the same airline. I know not everyone is in a position to say to management or to a band leader or to an employer, hey, I'm gonna do my own flights, or I must fly on this airline. I know that's just not possible to a certain point, but at a certain point, don't let it get into your 40s or, you know, I think I was probably around 30 years old when I was like, hard no, like I'm not flying Spirit or EasyJet or Ryanair or any of these dumpy airlines that just treat you like garbage. I say, I'm doing this and I'm totally fine. If you say no and you can't do that, you can't facilitate that for me, I'll stay home, it's fine. So you definitely find out who really wants you on the gig or not. You find out how much people are bullshitting you when they tell you, oh, we don't really have the money. And it's the irony at the end of the day, so many times, especially when you look around me here, all this gear, like you actually as a musician have to travel with a bunch of stuff, and it will cost whoever is flying you a bunch of money to check something at some point. And most of those dummy airlines, they charge you up the wazoo for all of those extra things. So if you have the status, you can do it all with one airline, that all comes included. When I when I stipulate, hey, I have to fly Star Alliance, mainly United if possible, I bring a bunch of things to the table there. I bring the fact that I can take three bags up to 70 pounds included in every flight. I also have the added bonus of if somebody's booking flights, we're all maybe coming from the same place and they can book everyone on the same itinerary, I get up to 9 people on the same itinerary with the same baggage allowance and all of those same benefits. So yeah, it's a tough one to make the break and to start saying no. But long term, again, if it suits the way you travel, the way you work, it's very specific the way I do it. If that's sort of a long term goal, if you know you're going to be flying, I know I'm going to be flying the rest of my life to do this, no matter how long or how short that is, it does and has made a lot of sense for me. Anyway, airline traveling rant over. Hope you enjoyed checking out some weird stuff, I gotta say. Some relics, some souvenirs, essentially, at this point. I hope you got some information out of that you can use for your career, for your situation, and maybe we'll be back in the bigger space doing other episodes like this, not too far in the future. Don't forget, this space right here, this Mayonnaise, is for sale. It's at my website, it's linked below. Same place you can get all the books, signed copies. I think we have some pentatonics and sight reading that just came in. Oh, and maybe chordal harmony. I know I got like 20 copies of 3 books. I think those are the 3, pentatonics, sight reading, and chordal harmony volume 1. All linked below. Signed copies shipping here, shipping from here worldwide. Physical copies, not signed, from Amazon. And of course, the digital copies at my website. Really appreciate you spending some time with me talking about music. Well, today, talking about gear, talking about bass, and see you all really soon.